Success Mantra is a program which features people, successful individuals from various walks of life. They are less known heroes who believe in their dreams and have conviction to live their full potential. Idols, icons, innovators who care to live every moment on their own terms.
Hello everyone, it's really a pleasure to be in another episode, and today we have a very, very special guest who has been, by my side all the time, a mentor, Didi, a person who's always there when you need her. So, she's none other than Rinadi, and she has been instrumental in upcoming of a lot of children as professionals in not only our neighborhood, but in many neighborhoods, and we are indebted to her. So I'm really very, very happy. Welcome, Rinadi, to our
you.
Show.
Thank you so much.
You know, our children are what they are today because of the values that you have given them.
They are because what they are. I just give them a nudge.
Absolutely. Always encouraging to parents as well as their children. So we want to know a little bit about, you know, what is your background before you started teaching?
I am a mother by choice and a teacher by instinct.
Wow, what a statement to make. Amazing. Fantastic. Yeah.
So I would say that probably this Kira about teaching came up when I was about 16 years or so, and we were staying in a neighborhood where I was the only common educated girl around this one surrounding, and there were parents who wanted to, you know, put their children in this convent schools,
sure.
And the kids didn't know how to articulate, they didn't know how to write, read or write, so they would come to me,
right.
And they would say that at a small fees, can you, and you know, way back in the late 70s, small fees like 40 rupees was a big thing for me, because that would be my pocket money for college, So I said, why not, let me give it a shot, and these kids would come to me and I would handheld them and teach them to write ABCD and teach them rhyme so that they could go and give their school test so that they could join those schools.
Right.
That was the initial time when I started teaching the kids, and I loved doing it.
Right.
At some level, I felt the kids were pretty, what you call that, they could understand me, I could get to them easily without, any problem was not, like they didn't want to come to me.
Absolutely.
They're pretty happy to come and sit down with me and get coached. Then we had these Iranian kids, because that time Iran was going through a turmoil, late 70s, and these Iranians had come down to India.
Okay.
It was a stepping stone for them to go from India to USA. But they had to get their kids educated in India for some time, so that they knew English, so that they could move to USA. Now, who was the best person around in the surrounding? It was me. So the Iranian kids, I was Rina Bhushal that time.
Oh, nice.
So the Iranian kids would come to me, and they didn't know anything other than Farsi. I didn't know anything other than English and Hindi.
Oh my God, how did you manage to teach?
That was a difficult thing. Like, it would be sign language. I would try to tell them, see, this is A and this is apple.
Right.
And then they would look at me and they didn't know anything. So I would go and get an apple. Say, this is A, this is an apple.
Innovative way of teaching. Nice.
Yeah. B, then I would get a ball. So this is B, ball. This is a ball. So they would say, okay, ball. That's how my teaching started.
Sure.
I was just part of, it was a fun thing for me to teach kids.
Mm-hmm.
So that is where my teaching really took off. Like, it wasn't my profession.
Right.
Working was my bread and butter. Okay. Teaching was my passion.
Beautiful. Excellent. So even Mitroda, when he was there,
he was a very passionate teacher.
And you know, I still remember those days when me as a parent, I would think, oh my God, what will happen to my kid? And both of you will say, you know, you are blessed, he's such an intelligent child. How did you manage that? Do you see every child as a, you know, intelligent one? Or what do you... What?
Every child is born intelligent. Take it from me, every child is born intelligent. If they are not, how do you think they walk on their own? Do we tell them? Walk? They do. They get up, they fall, but they still do. That itself shows they're intelligent. We don't want to tap their energy. The minute you start tapping their energy, tapping their intelligence, you will see that child blooming. And that is where it starts. But then when we are not positive, we start thinking negative, like, can my child do it? That question, when it comes to you, that is when the child can't bloom.
Absolutely.
You need to be positive about yourself and the child, you see? That is when, if you aren't, then how will your child bloom?
Very true.
The positivity that you radiate will also emanate from the child, right?
Right.
So, having that feel that, no, my kid can do it, itself is what makes a parent. We are all first time parents. We are not born parents.
And we are not trained to
be parents. We are not trained parents, right? Of course, nowadays you have how to train, how to be a good mother, how to be a good father. You have books on it. We didn't have that all. For us, it was all learning by experience. So once you start coaching children, you get to understand kids from a very close perspective. Like every child is a different individual. Every child is different. No two children are the same. You can't treat two kids the same way. Like when they are sitting together, they are different. You need to treat them differently. You need to respect the kids. You don't think the kids don't have respect. We say no, they do.
Right.
If you try to respect them, they will learn to respect you in return. I think that is very important in their upbringing. And that is something we forget sometimes.
So, you know, the one more thing I've always noticed, you have a beautiful relationship with your daughter. Nurture that relationship.
First of all, being a mother, as a mother, I can talk to you as a mother. You need to be transparent with your child. You need to trust them. If you don't trust them, they will never trust themselves. That's the foremost thing that a child needs. That you trust the child and the child in return. And if a child comes to you with a problem and you start berating the child, like, this is not how you should do it, this is how you should have done it. That is not how to bring up a child. You got to listen to the child. I can talk to you as a mother. You need to be transparent with your child. You need to trust them. If you don't trust them, they will never trust themselves. That's the foremost thing that a child needs. That you trust the child and the child in return. And if a child comes to you with a problem and you start berating the child, like, this is not how you should do it, this is how you should have done it. That is not how to bring up a child. You got to listen to the child, give a patient hearing, find out what the child is trying to tell you. And even if the child is wrong, don't tell that child then and there that you are wrong. No, this is not the way to do it. There are hundreds of ways of getting to the child diplomatically, telling them, calling a spade is a very nice thing to tell. It doesn't work in real life.
It doesn't work anywhere, right? Seen in my life in corporate or as a parent, as a mother.
You have to be... See, the child goes through a lot of things when it goes to the school. First time, first day in school, the kid is out of its safety zone. It's without its parents. It's an atmosphere where everything is new. The teacher is new. The children surrounding it. That's why the kids cry, right? When they go to school, the first day they start crying because they don't know what's happening to them.
I know.
So, like when the child comes back, you can't tell them, like, why were you crying? You shouldn't cry. That's bad manners. That's bad habit. You can't tell that to the child. You should say, it's okay. Tomorrow will be better. That is how you should treat
a
child.
How to build this patience as a parent? Because you're not just a parent, right? Because you're a professional. You're going through your own stress at work. And then you have so many other surrounding pressures in the environment. How do you build this patience?
Patience is something that has to come naturally to you. I think you can't build it just like that. You need to have that. And I think as parents, it's an innate thing that you have. Patience is something innate. The kids don't let you sleep all through the night. If you don't have patience, can you even go through your daily work? You'll be tired. We don't. We take care of them, get up in the morning, go about doing your own thing. You don't curse anybody. That itself is patience, right?
Absolutely. So, do you also feel that there is a certain age at which you can become a parent? Beyond that or before that is not the right thing to do?
Probably, I've known my mother-in-law who was married at 13, but I don't see her as a parent who was bad or who didn't do anything. So I would say it's a, but of course, I think it should be 18 plus to be a parent.
Going by the legal,
it should be 18 plus for today's generation.
I think biologically
age also it should be. The olden days are no longer applicable. So, but then, even if you're a parent at 13, 14, as I have seen my mother-in-law, she was a good mother. She knew how to bring up her kids even at that. The difference between her, my mother and my husband was only about, say, 17 years. That's how it is between siblings these days. But she was a mother to the core. There was nothing that she couldn't do that my husband wasn't scared of.
That's well said. So, this has been a beautiful journey, raising
being successful for me personally. But if you go by the dictionary, success can mean wealth, It can mean fame. It can also mean being rich.
Right.
Now, wealth for me, in that context, would be family and friend.
Right.
And fame would be like if I've been able to touch even one single child or one single human being in a lifetime, and if I have been able to make a difference to that person, for me that's fame, because for me the person recognized me for what I have done to them. That would be fame. Rich. All the people who love me around the place and the people whom I love, I think I'm rich that way. That's my personal feeling.
Very well.
I don't know about others, but yeah, that's for me. Rich is not being having a lot of money and having materialistic things.
Right.
You need that.
You need the basics.
You need the basics.
Yeah.
But rich can mean many things, you know.
True.
It's a very relative term. Rich in friendship, rich in love, and rich in, you know, blah blah, everything put together. So rich is not just about being what you call wealthy and money and having three cars and a bungalow. Having a lot of friends and being able to lead your life the way you want to lead is also being rich. So that is how, for me, I think that is being successful in life. And if I able to have achieved that a little bit, I would think my life is
excellent.
A success.
Absolutely, bang on. So, you know, one of the things which I always want to ask all teachers, all educators and educationists, in our country, teachers are not given that pedestal, right? As in, you know, like teaching job, okay, you know, your teaching means you're just, it's not given that weightage of a true professional. However, they are the ones who are really building nation. What would you like to tell youngsters in context to this? Should they opt for this as a profession, or do you think this is something?
If it was say a generation away, I would say no, because definitely the teachers were not paid well. Teachers had to make a life.
True.
They had a family.
I started as
they were not respected.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But in today's scenario, I would tell the youngsters, there's no harm in being a teacher.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Monetarily they are paid well. They are well taken care of by the schools or colleges that you teach in. So it's a very noble profession, I would say. Now, if you want to be a teacher, you have to have that passion for teaching.
Sure.
You don't go to teach to just make money.
Right.
You go to teach because you want to teach. You
but
want
isn't
to impart
for
your
all professions.
Is it?
As in, if you're not passionate, how do you sustain those long hours?
You don't. That is why,
and everything,
that
right?
is why people don't stick on to a particular job for long nowadays, right? In the earlier days, you would find a teacher who worked for 30 years, 35 years and then retired, and the teacher would be given a garland and a bouquet, and then you would all clap together.
Lifetime achievement.
Yeah. But for the teacher, I think that was an honor.
True.
They didn't expect anything more than that.
Mm.
But being a teacher, as I said, is a profession that doesn't match up to anything else on this earth.
Absolutely.
Because
we make doctors,
we make engineers, we make pilots, we make anybody on this earth. Right?
Beautiful.
So,
like,
nothing can beat a teacher.
Absolutely.
Any day, given if they pay me or they don't pay me, I'm willing to teach kids. I'm always there for them.
I like that sentiment and that spirit, because, you know, like, that's one thing which people need to understand, that they are the true nation builders,
they
right?
are the
in context.
All
of, you
the
know,
teachers are the
do.
True nation builders. But
the
thing is, now people, some teachers are taking up the profession just because they want to be in that field. They don't have anything else to do.
Right.
But are they
that's
a teacher?
Sad.
That is something that we need to understand. But of course, 90% of the teachers are teachers because they want to be teachers. That's what I think.
Well said.
The 10% in any field, you have that 10% here and there where
Absolutely.
People are there because they have no other choice.
Excellent.
Right? But most of them are there because they have a passion for teaching. Otherwise, we will not have these kids coming out in flying colors.
Yeah,
in the
very well said. I think the government and other bodies should be a little
more
sensitive
proactive
about the teaching community.
And start thinking that we have Dronacharyas in the making.
Yeah,
and we need to take care of them.
Right.
Make it a little more lucrative, so that we have more teachers coming
in for this profession.
Yes.
I'm not saying that, okay, that's bottom of the list. That should be the top of the list.
Correct.
In places like Finland and all, they prioritize so much.
I had a friend who was a CA in our company in Bangalore. But once she left India and she went to work in the... she went to Kuwait, I think.
Okay.
She quit her profession as a CA and she became a teacher. She loved teaching and it paid her well.
Wow.
I hope it's the same here in our country.
Absolutely. So, Reena Gandhi, the other thing, like you said, that, you know, people are your wealth that you have maintained these relationships. It's so beautiful to watch this. So, tell us a little bit about the traits and, you know, the qualities or behaviors which has really helped you nurture this wealth in your life.
First of all, I think that's my opinion about myself,
right.
that I'm a people person.
Mm-hmm.
I love interacting with anybody,
right.
from a child of 2 years to a
maybe that I see.
Person.
Absolutely. I can vouch for that. Yeah.
It's easy for me. I don't know how. Maybe it's God's gift. I have no clue, but it doesn't take me a minute to gel with somebody in front of me. Even I have thought a kid was 2.5 years, the mother.
So tell us, which has been the most amazing, you know, achievement in your life? When you look back, you feel, wow, this is really
There are many, many things. Now, every stage of my life, something has been amazing. Like when I was a 5-year-old, my first race was amazing. Okay, for me, that was like something. I looked at everybody and my dad said, this and I was thrilled, like I have achieved the world, like I've done something great. It was just a race. Okay. And then when I was in school, in my middle school, I did well in my studies and my dad said, go. That was an achievement for me.
Yeah.
That was amazing, like I've done something.
Yeah.
And then when I went to college, I stood first. Again, I felt, oh, this is my achievement.
Yeah.
So every stage of life, you know, your achievements and your success and all this keep changing. It doesn't remain the same.
True.
So, it's amazing. My life is amazing. I feel our life is amazing.
Very nice. Beautiful. And Reena, tell us a little bit about, you know, like you have gone through in recent times. You've gone through a lot of challenges.
Yes.
How did you deal with them? Because a lot of people break down when such things.
See, the first thing about 5 years back when my husband was detected with cancer. And the day we were coming back from the hospital, I still remember that vividly. And I don't know, instinctively I knew that he had very little chance because the doctor had said that his cancer had spread to his liver. And when it spreads to the liver, it's almost, you know, like it's a death knell. And when I asked the doctor what could they do best, they said probably 2.5 years of his life at the most and not more than that.
Mm.
So that's when we decided that, my husband decided that he would not go through any operations and he would lead his life the way he is. And probably, you know, leave this world. Though I wanted him to go through the operation, he said no, he didn't want to do it. So that was a big challenge for me when we came back home and, you know, the atmosphere of the house changed from us being so positive and, you know, like a happy-go-lucky family. It was like a sudden boulder on our head. We don't know how to move forward. I don't know what my husband was thinking. But every day was a challenge for me. Every day was a challenge. Seeing him, you know, slowly deteriorating his health and having sleepless nights and taking care of him, going to the hospitals. But on the hindsight, I would say it has taught me to be more resilient, become more strong, accept death, and you can't challenge it. And there's something called destiny. If it has to come, there's no way you can avoid it. And I've accepted that. But the acceptance didn't come easily. It took me a lot of time to, you know, accept the fact
deal
that
with
deal
it.
With it. And then me, 3 years later down the line, again being stuck with cancer, it wasn't so difficult for me. It was very difficult for my daughters. Because for them, having seen their dad in that state and then seeing their mother, somewhere I felt a little guilty and I was very angry with God. If there is a God somewhere, I said, why should it happen to me? It's happened to my husband, my kids have gone through it, now I'm going through it. But then, you know, when I look back, I feel, and I've studied about it, and I've seen other people suffering, I think I have been given a chance to live, and I should be happy about it. There are a lot many people who don't even get a chance, right?
So I think COVID is a classic,
classic case. And I shouldn't be cribbing about it. I shouldn't be cribbing about my life. I did my operation at the right time. I'm speaking with you right now. I think that's enough for me. I'm alive today. I think I'm happy about it. What will happen tomorrow? I don't need to know and I don't want to know. Future, let it come. I'll face it when it does.
I said,
and that this learning has not come easily. It took a lot of, say, you know, mental. I had to build up my mental strength, do a lot of meditation and say, God, okay, fine. You have given this to me. It's a challenge. I'll accept it. And I'll go through it. I'll go through it. And so far, I have been able to, you know, stick to my own word, my own promise. I'm fine. And I hope I'll continue.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the very fact, it's so inspiring to see you deal with this entire challenge with a smiling face.
Yeah.
And you know, it just doesn't feel every time I see you, it's not just now, it's everywhere I meet you, you're like, life is great, going great, yeah. What are you doing? Yeah. So,
well, tell me something, yeah. if you crib about your life, yeah. you think the other person in front of you will like it? No, nobody's going to like it. Nobody likes talking about the things that's happening to you, the bad things that's happening to you. Nobody likes to hear it. It's nice not to talk about it. It's okay when somebody wants to know in detail and you tell them what's happening to you. But otherwise, if your life is fine, you say it's fine. Mm. Why do you say, yeah, it's so-so? I don't understand that word.
Yeah.
My life is so-so. What do you mean by your life is so-so? It's either good or it's not good.
Okay, and the other thing is, whatever you focus on tends to expand. Why even focus there? Let's just enjoy.
I believe in being positive. That's one big thing that I believe. Always. Always, like as kids also, my dad was from the armed forces and he had to go with the UN force for this Congo civil war and all that. He was there for 3 years. So we were left alone. But then he always said, think positive. Nothing is going to happen to me as long as you believe in me. So I got that from him. He was a very strong person and I think that's probably it's in the DNA. So, yeah.
Beautiful. No, yesterday we were watching, just wanted to mention this. Yesterday we were watching this movie, Shershah. And you know, it's his life, yes, right? At the age of 25, he sacrificed his life for the country. And we had tears in our eyes. And his brother saying that, you know, he has really served the country so well. So we are proud of whatever he has done, even at that age.
Right.
So life.
He fought to live only for the age of 25. Okay. So I should be happy that I'm still alive. That's enough for me. Right now, and I shouldn't be cribbing about it. I think that's what I tell everybody else who's gone through something like me. I said, it's okay, you have gone through it, you have come out of it. Let's be positive about it. That's the best thing you can do to yourself. You can't be harsh on yourself,
right?
You cannot,
And it's not in your hands,
it's not,
it's not that you are doing everything,
no, right,
true. And have you had, like, you have a beautiful life where every milestone is so precious, right? How did you deal with the failures?
Okay, when you say failure, look, if failure wasn't there, would the word success ever exist? Okay, success is there because there is failure. And what's failure? Failure is positive. If you don't fail in something, you will never want to challenge yourself to go to the next thing, right? Because I failed today, I want to do better, so I take the next step. If there wasn't this failure in me and I feel that everything is going gung-ho and gaga, then what's the meaning of
depression? Some people get into this depressive mode, right? So how do they come out?
Because they can't take failure as a challenge. They can't take failure as it comes. They can't accept that they can fail. And that we need to teach the children. For the first and foremost thing that you need to teach your children is failure is part and parcel of your life. If you fail today, it doesn't mean it's the end of the world. If you fail today, there will be a day when this day will pass and you'll have a better day where you'll do better and you'll forget there was a failure, right? You forget. That time you forget because that time you're basking in the glory of
success.
We all forget. We are human beings after all. Do you remember any failure? I don't remember. And that we need to teach the children. But the first and foremost thing that you need to teach your children is failure is part and parcel of your life. If you fail today, it doesn't mean it's the end of the world. If you fail today, there will be a day when this day will pass and you will have a better day where you will do better and you will forget there was a failure. If you didn't have failure, then the word success will hold no meaning, right? In the books it says failure, opposite is success. So you have to have failure. Nobody goes,
it's like night and day.
The graph doesn't always go up. Yeah. It's always this way. There is an ups and downs in life. The graph says the truth. So there's a failure, then there's a success. Again, there will be a failure, then be a success. You can't have success all your life, you can't have failures all your life. Jack Ma wouldn't be Jack Ma if he didn't have failures, right?
I know.
He's a big example for all the youngsters nowadays. And I believe in that. Absolutely.
So excellent. Thank you so much. And you know, like your speed and your energy is like absolutely enviable. And I'm really glad that
I love talking to you.
You finally made it to the show. You know, like so many people are going to get energy and enthusiasm out of this.
My pleasure and my honor to be here.
There's
with
one
you.
Last question. Yeah. What is your message? What is this mantra that you want to give okay. to people which can help them?
My mantra or message, whatever you call it, to the youth would be trust. Trust in yourself. If you don't trust yourself, nobody else will. Confidence, the most important thing in your life is having confidence. No matter what you do, don't lose your confidence. That's a very important thing in your life. And enjoy your life. Hardships will come and they will go. They are not the end all. There is a better day. There is a tomorrow. It doesn't end today, right? There is a tomorrow. And if you look at it, and also, I think you need to be more sustainable in life. The world is changing now, as we can see, the climate changes and whatever is happening in the world. The youth should learn that they need to sustain the world. They are the tomorrow. They need to take care of Earth. We have done our bit. I don't know whether good or bad, but they need to do it. It's our advice to them, and I hope they carry forth this and lead the life the best way they can. That's all I can say. Enjoy your life. Enjoy your life always. Hardships will come no matter what, but they'll also go away. They will go away.
Right.
And we have experienced it. They will also experience it.
Absolutely.
Everybody learns on their go.
And life. Right. Beautiful. Thank you so much, Inadi, for being on the show. Yeah. I'm sure that each one of our audience have benefited from the kind of courage that you have shown in your journey of life. And of course, as a teacher, as a mentor, you are always there for everyone.
Always. Anybody, anytime. At least for the kids, I'm always there.
Thank you.